The history of Japanese bronchoscopy started in 1907. Within the broad stream of 95 years until today's flourishing art, I have to mention especially three key persons who took very important roles at each historical turning point. The first person is Inokichi Kubo, the first Japanese bronchoscopist who opened the door of Japanese bronchology. Inokichi Kubo, known as Ino Kubo, was born on December 26, 1874 in a small village in Fukushima Prefecture. The boy Ino was very diligent, willingly helped in housework and nursing his small brother and sister. At the age of 16, he started school life in Tokyo. It was enjoyable, however, his financial situation was extremely difficult. Meantime, he began to write tanka poems, a still popular special kind of Japanese verse of 31 syllables. Soon, he became recognized as one of the most excellent tanka poets. In 1900, Kubo graduated from Tokyo University Medical School at the age of 26 and began working as otorhinolaryngologist at Tokyo University. The specialty was very new and represented at a few institutions only, working not only as a chief of the ENT department, but also as an editor of the journal. In the evening, he gave lectures to a private study group on ENT. All of his co-workers respected him very much as an exceptional hard-working person, but nobody ever heard him complaining, "I am busy" or "I am tired." In 1903, Inokubo was awarded a grant by the Japanese government to go to Germany. So first, he went to Freiburg, which had become mecca of bronchoscopy due to Kilian's high reputation. Hundreds of physicians came from all over the world. Kubo soon became Kilian's most faithful student because of his intelligence and amiable personality. Working at Freiburg University, he acquired the most advanced knowledge and techniques of the time. When he left Freiburg, Kilian presented him an ink pot for memory. Not only this ink pot, but of course he did not forget to pack some Kilian-type bronchoscopes into his suitcase. And these are the instruments that opened the new field of Japanese medicine. In January 1907, he returned to Japan to become professor of otorhinolaryngology at Kyushu University in Fukuoka. 8 months later, in September 1907, he performed the first bronchoscopy in Japan. Using the Kilian-type bronchoscope, he succeeded to remove a foreign body, a drum tack, from the left main bronchus of a 14-year-old boy. In those times, the common method for removing a foreign body from the airway was to irritate the airway with a feather via tracheotomy. Therefore, the bronchoscopic method, which didn't require tracheotomy, really made the audience astonished. Some criticized the method as dangerous. However, the bronchoscopic method was very efficient for retrieval of foreign bodies. More than 2,000 foreign bodies were removed from the airways as well as from esophagus using the endoscope in the ENT department of Kyushu University during his service. Furthermore, Kubo explored the frontiers of this field and established new methods one after another. This photo shows the successful treatment of life-threatening compression of the trachea by a tuberculous gravitation abscess in spinal caries. The endoscopic incision and drainage of peritracheoesophageal abscess saved the 17-year-old boy's life. Kubo's first steps as the Japanese pioneer of bronchoscopy were exceptionally great. Until his retirement, he continued to be the leader who established modern bronchoesophagology and otorhinolaryngology in Japan. His memory is preserved in the Kubo Museum at Kyushu University, Fukuoka. In 1934, the year of Kubo's retirement, a new leader appeared. Joe Ono came back to Japan from the United States with Jackson-type bronchoscopes. He is the second key person who contributed greatly to the widespreading of bronchology in Japan. Joe Ono was born in 1898, the year after Killian's first bronchoscopy, in Fukushima Prefecture, coincidentally the same place as Ino Kubo. At the age of 16, he went to the United States. He studied medicine at Lafayette University and Jefferson University in Pennsylvania and obtained MD. In 1932, Ono started to study bronchoesophagology under Chevalier Jackson. Chevalier Jackson is very famous as the person who established the modern bronchoesophagology in the United States. When Joe Ono came back to Japan with the Jackson-type bronchoesophagoscope in 1934, only Killian-type and Brunning's-type were available. Shinichi Chiba had already introduced Brunning's-type scopes to Japan in 1910. The Jackson-type scope with a small lamp at its tip made everybody astonished. In 1949, he was invited to Keio University as a visiting professor. In those days, shortly after the World War II, Japan was extremely poor. Due to shortage of food and houses, tuberculosis was raging all through Japan. So anti-tuberculosis plans had to be carried out urgently. In this situation, for correct diagnosis of tuberculosis and decision for the surgical procedure, the importance of bronchoscopy had become recognized. Therefore, Ono began to hold training courses. Before that, bronchoscopy was mainly a procedure for retrieval of foreign bodies that otorhinolaryngologists performed. However, now the surgeons and internists began to obtain the knowledge and technique of bronchoscopy for treatment of tuberculosis. Starting in 1949, during 15 years, Ono held 51 courses. The number of participants from all over Japan counted 1,169. Thus, he contributed greatly to spread bronchoscopy widely in Japan. In the procedure of rigid bronchoscopy, the assistant plays a very important role in holding the patient's head. During the course, Ono was always a very enthusiastic teacher and tried to show all the procedures to every 20 to 30 participants. Therefore, it took very long time. The assistant had to keep holding the patient's head against the paresthetic feeling in his arms. So in his mind, he might be shouting to Dr. Ono, "Doctor, oh no!" Several participants of the first course recognized the necessity for a professional organization. Therefore, in the same year, 1949, the Japanese Society for Bronchoesophagology was established, and Ono was elected as first president. In 1958, the 7th WCBE, the World Congress for Bronchoesophagology, was held in Kyoto. Only 7 years later, 11th WCBE was held in Hakone. Both meetings were successful not only for scientific level, but also for the friendly relationship between bronchoesophagologists from all over the world. Besides science, The Japanese Society for Bronchoesophagology took a very important role in the field of social activities. These are the pencil caps, airway foreign bodies. The right one was retrieved by Ono from the right middle lobe bronchus of 11-year-old boy in 1956. In those days, pencil caps were frequent airway foreign bodies. The society made a petition to change its design. With holes at the tip in order to avoid at least airway obstruction. You see, all plastic caps produced after 1960s have holes. Furthermore, they succeeded in prohibiting the production and sales of dangerous toys that could cause suffocation against the strong opposition by toy companies. How many children's lives will have been saved by these activities? In the 1960s, when the plastic pencil caps were produced, bronchology was developing with increasing speed before the next great innovation. In 1962, Ono had to make a movie presentation on esophagoscopy during a congress. For that purpose, Ono asked Shigeto Ikeda to produce a film on that technique. Ikeda developed an esophageal telescope using glass fibers as light guide and made a film on esophagoscopy. When Ono presented this movie at the Congress, the audience praised its very clear image. Shigeto Ikeda is the person who developed bronchofibroscope and brought the revolution in bronchology. Shigeto Ikeda was born on July 1, 1925 in Tokyo. His father was a practitioner. Since childhood, he was very inquisitive, especially about machinery and very much interested in cameras and 8mm movies. In the summer of his 23rd year, when Ikeda was a medical student in Keio University, he fell ill of tuberculosis pleurisy. But he decided never to give up and overcome tuberculosis to become a doctor to treat patients suffering from the same disease. Indeed, he overcame several hardships as absence from school for a few months for treatment, his father's sudden death, and surgical procedures. Finally, he became a thoracic surgeon himself and worked at the ward of tuberculosis. He made his hope become realized. In those days, bronchography was an important method for diagnosis and decision for indication of surgery in tuberculosis. Ikeda began bronchography as his own work, performing 50 cases in a week, 2,000 cases in a year. For 10 years, he did no less than 20,000 procedures of bronchography. One day, when he was so eagerly taking movies of bronchography, he suddenly fell ill from irradiation exposure and had to be urgently hospitalized. In 1962, Ikeda moved to the National Cancer Center, founded a few months ago. The president Shichiro Ishikawa recognized Ikeda's talent and potential, which was what this newly established institute needed. Here, with Eitaka Tsuboi, he began diagnosis for lung cancer using the Tsuboi type curette. At the same time, he was performing rigid bronchoscopy. But with rigid bronchoscopes, the observation range was restricted. Furthermore, under local anesthesia, it caused considerable discomfort to the patient. Is there any good method to observe the deeper part of bronchus that does not torture the patient? The development of a new method was the earnest desire of many other pulmonologists and thoracic surgeons. In those days, many people were trying to apply glass fiber technology for medical use. In 1962, Ikeda with Kenichi Takino and Shohei Horie succeeded to apply glass fibers to the rigid scope for brighter illumination instead of the small lamp. In the same year, Ikeda developed the above-mentioned device to extend a glass fiber bundle to connect to a more powerful light source, and named it the rigid-type bronchoscopic telescope. Then he got an idea to develop the flexible bronchoscope using glass fibers also for imaging. If this idea could be realized, it would be obvious that not only patients' discomfort should be reduced, but also diagnosis would become more certain. Nothing but the development of the scope must be my duty. Ikeda was firmly convinced of that. It would be just a dream considering the level of those days' technology. However, for a scientist, dream is the source of creation. And the image of the ideal bronchoscope was becoming clearer and clearer. In January 1964, Ikeda asked Haruhiko Machida of Machida Endoscope Company to produce the flexible bronchofiber scope. Ikeda indicated 9 requirements for that. Outer diameter less than 6 mm, image guide fiber thinner than 15 micrometer, more than 15,000 in a bundle, and so on. Oh my God, Machida shouted. Do I have to satisfy all of these requirements? Everything seemed the most difficult subject that Machida had never experienced. In fact, it was far more difficult work for Machida than he had expected. After many series of trials and errors for more than 2 years, it was on July 23, 1966, that Machida finally visited Ikeda with the first model. The first bronchofibroscope in the world was born. Ikeda's hands were slightly trembling with excitement. It was only 3 weeks before the 9th World Congress on Disease of Chest in Copenhagen, Denmark. Therefore, using the scope, Ikeda immediately took a 16mm movie titled The Development of the Bronchofibroscope and flew to Copenhagen. After oral and film presentation, Ikeda took the actual scope out of his pocket and showed it to the audience. This is the bronchofibroscope that I have developed. Just at the moment, people rushed toward the stage to look at it closely. The chairman was embarrassed with his confusion. Dr. Ikeda, would you please go out and show it in the lobby? We have still other presentations to be continued. So Ikeda went out, but half of the audience followed him to the lobby with great excitement. After that, when he was walking in the Congress Hall, many doctors frequently asked him, "Are you Dr. Ikeda? Would you please show me your flexible bronchofibroscope?" However, this first model had still several problems. After some improvement, he could finally get a sufficient tool in July 1967 for clinical application with U-turn angulation and inside channel for anesthetic agent and biopsy forceps. This scope could come onto the market. On the other hand, Olympus Company also succeeded to develop the first practical scope in 1970 to be commercialized. In September 1968, the NIH, National Institute of Health, invited Ikeda to the United States. In Johns Hopkins University in Baltimore, he gave a lecture on the bronchofibroscope, showing a film. On the film, they watched the bronchofibroscope going into the bronchi deeper and deeper where they had never seen before. All of the audience was so much excited to clap their hands and step their feet. In 1970, he was invited to Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota, to teach the practical application of the bronchofibroscope to the doctors in Mayo Clinic. The main reason of the invitation was to apply bronchofibroscope to the Mayo Lung Project, the evaluation of the effectiveness of mass screening for lung cancer. Thus, Ikeda's invention spread all over the world and brought a revolution to medicine and bronchology. In the 1970s in Japan, according to the increase of lung cancer, the relation between smoking and lung cancer was frequently talked in the mass media to attract people's attention. Ikeda, having been stimulated by the Mayo Lung Project, keenly realized the necessity of the early detection and mass screening. So, supported by a grant from the Ministry of Health and Welfare Japan, the first Ikeda group was organized in 1972 for the study on diagnosis of Hodgkin type early lung cancer. They started accumulating the data on Hodgkin type early lung cancer up to 100 cases. According to the analysis, they concluded that Hodgkin type early lung cancer could be effectively detected in the patients with cough or bloody sputum by 3-day pooled sputum cytology, and its localization could be determined by bronchofibroscope. The second Ikeda group mainly discussed about the early detection of peripheral small nodular type lung cancer, and the third group studied effective mass screening system. As the result of this 15 years investigation, the Japan type detection system for early lung cancer was established. Chest X-ray for peripheral type and sputum cytology for the high-risk group for Hodgkin type early lung cancer. The stream of this study was succeeded by Tsuguo Naruke and Masahiro Kaneko. In 1990s, in several areas in Japan, the effectiveness of this type of mass screening system had been proved with the statistic significance. In 1975, the Anti-Lung Cancer Association in Tokyo was organized. This is a fee-charging membership screening system for over 40-year-old heavy-smoking males. The members were examined chest X-ray twice a year and 3-day pooled sputum cytology. Since the helical CT was introduced in 1993, as very small nodule is easily detected, the 5-year survival rate has been raised to 83% from 49%. As the bronchofibroscope made the observation of smaller bronchi more easily, the former nomenclature of the tracheobronchial tree had become inconvenient. Therefore, Ikeda established new practical nomenclature, as you well know. Ikeda also became a visiting professor of Kitasato University, where he held a regular conference. Furthermore, he continued to have study courses for the practitioners in Kanagawa Prefecture. At first, in order to understand basic three-dimensional anatomy of lung, all the participants made the wire model of tracheobronchial tree. By this method, their X-ray reading ability was greatly improved. In those days, bronchofibroscope had been already widely prevailed all over Japan. The study meetings were frequently held independently in various places by enthusiastic young investigators. In Tokyo area, Kanto Study Group for Bronchology was organized in 1974. In the same year, also Kinki Group started the activity. Ikeda felt the necessity to standardize the bronchology, so he asked Shigeki Hitomi to have the joint meeting in Osaka. In April 1978, the first meeting of Japanese Study Group for Bronchology was held. This was held under collaboration of Kinki and Kanto Group. 200 bronchoscopists from all over Japan attended this first joint meeting and discussed very enthusiastically. And the study groups of each area were organized as its branches. Since then, this meeting was held once a year, and 5 years later, re-established as Japan Society for Bronchology. In July 1978, the first World Congress on Bronchoscopy was held in Tokyo. 660 bronchoscopists from 26 countries gathered together. In the next year, 1979, the World Association for Bronchology was established. Its office was placed in Tokyo, and Ikeda was elected as the president. Ikeda not only developed the instrument, but also devoted his energy for national and international societies for bronchologists to facilitate further study. From 1983, Ikeda with Ryosuke Ono started to develop the video bronchoscope equipped with a CCD camera at the tip. The first type was successfully produced in 1987 with Asahi Pentax. It is so-called the third revolution in bronchology. The video bronchoscope was also produced by other companies and from 1990s explosively prevailed to become the main device today. But in 1979, the first cerebral infarction attacked Ikeda, followed by repeated myocardial infarction as well as cerebral infarction. Nevertheless, he was not defeated, but continued to fight against the disease with the spirit of never give up. His wife, Taeko, supported him devotedly. In recent years, on the wheelchair driven by his wife, he continued to encourage his pupils at the Congress, which he himself has established. On December 25th, 2001, finally he passed away. Acute myocardial infarction suddenly deprived his life. The great star has fallen. In his funeral, hundreds of colors, flowers, and telegrams for condolence from all over the world showed how great his achievements were and how wide his friendly relationship was. Once again, I would like to express my deep condolence to Dr. Ikeda. Also, many doctors followed Ikeda and had been studying frontier fields of bronchology. Takashi Arai proved that transbronchial lung biopsy using bronchofibroscope is a very effective method. In addition, he developed the ring arm fluoroscope. Harubumi Kato developed photodynamic therapy and opened the possibility of curative treatment for Hiller type early lung cancer by endoscopic approach. Recently, the ultra-thin bronchoscope of 2.8 mm outer diameter was developed. This scope can reach just adjacent site to the peripheral Cohen lesion. For intractable pneumothorax, bronchial embolization with EWS developed by Yoichi Watanabe is the most recent effective method. At the same time, new technologies by foreign doctors have always been stimulating further development of Japanese bronchology, like autofluorescence bronchoscopy developed by Stephen Lam or endobronchial ultrasonography EBUS by Heinrich De Becker. Especially on EBUS, Noriaki Kurimoto's work is excellent. In 1990s, according to the increase of stenting and laser treatment, people again recognized the usefulness of the rigid bronchoscope. Therefore, in 1998 in Hiroshima, the 21st Annual Congress of Japan Society for Bronchology was held under the main theme of interventional bronchoscopy, inviting Dumont and the other European pioneers. This was arranged by Teruomi Miyazawa, who contributed to open the new era of Japanese bronchoscopy, of the combination of rigid and flexible bronchoscopes. Finally, in June 2000, the 11th WCB and WCBE was held in Yokohama, where 796 members from 33 countries all over the world met under the motto of the state of the art in the digital age. Early in 20th century, Gustav Killian in Germany taught Ino Kubo, who opened the door of Japanese bronchology. A quarter century later, after learning at Chevalier Jackson in the United States, Joe Ono promoted the widespread of bronchoscopy all over Japan. Next, Shigeto Ikeda in Japan became the leader of world bronchology. Recently in bronchology, international cooperation has been established. In the new century, we don't need borders anymore. Reflecting the history of bronchology in Japan, we are proud that we inherited the great works of forerunners. Therefore, holding up Ikeda's motto, never give up, all of us should be torch runners. Going hand in hand with bronchoscopists all over the world to go ahead for further progress. This should be our duty at the beginning of new 21st century.